Hi, thank you very much for inviting me to speak. It's really provoking to put what I'm going to talk about next door to something at the scale of Fukushima, but maybe there are resonances. So I wanted to talk about this business of what we do, a lot of us in that room. We are trying to make change happen, we're trying to affect how culture takes place, how politics takes place, we're trying to reach people. We're trying to do many, many things, and I've become very interested recently in thinking about how negative everybody seems to be about failure. And I got invited by Jess to write something about that. So I've looked into it quite a lot. And I came across this notion that if we can embrace failure more openly and honestly, then perhaps we can actually educate our hope. So in terms of success breeding hope, that actually when things don't work, we should be seen as the breeding hope. And of course, funders don't like that, but they should. So I'm going to very quickly sort of really give you some. I just made this up today for a project that I was involved in recently. So I'm subtitling this "The Bus They Couldn't Sink." So you're seeing there an image of a sculpture that, even before it got to where we wanted it to get to, got dropped in the Thames and damaged. So I'm just going to. Sorry, the formatting seems to be a bit weird, but it was fine on the train, you know how it is. So why do we have to tell everything that it's a success? I want to think about this, especially in light perhaps of Yumi's song, how do we approach the before and the after? How do we do that? How can we possibly get it right in these enormous situations we find ourselves in? What does right mean? So in thinking about this, I found myself reading a book by Sarah Amsler called The Education of Radical Democracy. Because I was thinking to myself as an arts educator, as an artist, as cultural workers, you know, isn't this actually what a lot of us think we're trying to do? We're trying to involve ourselves in the rebirth of democracy. And how can we educate hope? And how can we educate hope through embracing failure? And so the story I particularly want to tell you is about some work I've been doing along with others in Platform, which is an arts activist group based in London. And we do work around environmental and human rights impacts, particularly British companies and the British state, on ourselves, but also on the rest of the world. This is an amazing photograph, aerial satellite picture of the Niger Delta in Nigeria, which is one of the world's greatest bread baskets, as they call them, fertility. I'm also aware it's really hot in here, and I don't know about you, but there's a big danger of overheating. So some of you will remember the story of oil company involvements in Nigeria. And it does relate to the Fukushima example, because we're talking about how corporates, big business, intervenes in the life of the people. Environmental health of nature of people. And in Platform, we were doing a lot of work about the oil industry and climate change. And we were particularly following what was going on in Nigeria because of Shell, oil company Shell. And this is how the oil companies see Nigeria, the Niger Delta. So if that's the NASA photograph from space, which is this extraordinary delta, this is the size of Belgium. Yeah? That's what it looks like from space. That's what it looks like to oil companies, Shell, Chevron, etc. So it has been exploited for its oil for over 50 years by British companies. And they have taken full advantage of very, very low environmental standards in Nigeria, which is, of course, the post-imperial context for Britain. And it's completely and utterly devastating what has happened in the Niger Delta. There are parts of the Niger Delta where the combination of this sort of earth that you see here and burnt earth from explosions that have happened in poor infrastructure are two double-decker buses deep. That is how bad the situation is. So when we talk about rehabilitation and reconstruction and the anxieties about that, it's so real in Nigeria as well as in situations like Fukushima. Very quickly, Kensari was a writer and an activist and a campaigner and a businessman. And he was executed by the Nigerian military for his stand criticising Shell on what they were doing in his area of the Delta. Again, pardon for the formatting. Ogoniland. And he and eight colleagues were hung in a trumped up court for protesting against Shell in Nigeria. So what did we do, who've been working on Shell? We decided to commission a public art memorial to try and intervene in the kind of common sense stories that were going on here around, that were kind of quite post-colonial and imperial about Nigeria, but also Shell in Nigeria. We commissioned, it was a huge process for us, we commissioned, had an international competition. Sakari Douglas Camp won the competition. It was all a big press opportunity. She created her battle bus. We launched it with The Guardian. We were trying to get as much media as possible. As a campaigning organization, quite good at that. We had it toured all around England. We were really, really vociferous in doing events around it, on it, in it, on top of it, outside it, and putting it in places where nobody was expecting. And in 2015, which was 20 years after the execution of Ken Saro-Wiwa and Ogoniland, we decided that remembering wasn't enough, and we needed to up the action. And so the bus was revitalized and sent again around London. You may recognize that this site is the Stephen Lawrence Center where it was for a year. It's also been at Goldsmith, it's also been in Liverpool and Manchester, and also it's the Glastonbury Festival. And here it is in Peckham Square, just down the road in 2015, which is the best place it's ever been in terms of the community who we were engaging with those issues. We're working with Peckham Platform Gallery. And the thing that's been provoking about the bus for a lot of people is it's not just this kind of aesthetic you may know from Sakari Douglas Camp's work of this welded steel, which is very much part of her aesthetic, referencing, for her anyway, what a lot of the kind of mend aesthetic is in Nigeria, where she's from. But it's also, she decided to inscribe it with this accusation. So it's not only a public memorial, it's an accusation. And it's an accusation that carries on working. As people walk around the bus, they see the words, "I accuse the oil companies of practicing genocide against the Ugandan people." Now this has been going on, this situation has been going on for 50 years, alright? And Ken Saro-Wiwa's execution with the Ogoni 9 was in 1995, so that's 20 years since that crime was committed. We're not going to look at this video, but I can make this PowerPoint available to you. What we decided to do for Action Saro-Wiwa was to test whether a sculpture that had been commissioned 10 years before, that had been touring around England, could actually be used as a sort of what Chris Ophelia would call a mind bomb, and actually send it to Nigeria. What would happen if we sent this sculpture to Nigeria? So we raised money, we went way beyond our comfort zone in terms of international art shipping, and we sent the bus to Nigeria at the invitation of the Movement for the Survival of the Ogoni People, who wanted this memorial to help revitalize their campaign in Nigeria, because their campaign was flagging. Talk about hope. How do you keep going with a 50-year injustice, with a 100-year injustice, with a 400-year injustice, such as finding in West Africa? Before the bus even got to Nigeria, rather suspiciously, okay, that hasn't worked. Never mind. Before the bus even got to Nigeria, rather mysteriously, Port of Tilbury, somewhere between Port of Tilbury and Grimaldi shipping lines, dropped the bus in the Thames. So before we can even test out how the Nigerian authorities would react to the bus, which we had scenario planned, the bus fell into the Thames and we had to spend £6,000 repairing it and reshipping it. Fell into the Thames. So, tried to sink the bus. All the bus was attempted to sunk, even before it left England. We can talk more about that. So hope was tested. The Igoni were waiting for it. They were hoping for it as part of their mobilisation since 2015. Then, when the bus finally got there, the bus was seized by Lagos customs. This we were expecting. So then we knew what to do. You can generate press. You can generate interest, you can generate outrage. And these links, which I don't know why they're not working, were taken to the website where it shows you, you know, many, many statements from different artists around the world demanding the bus is released as a direct parallel to what has gone on in Nigeria for the past 50 years. That it's another shutdown, freedom of expression is another shutdown of the demands of the Igbo people, and not just the Igbo people, but for justice in the Delta. So we knew what to do with that. And our allies in Nigeria were mobilising. It was a great cause for them because they could say that they're doing it again. A whole new generation could come up and mobilise around this artwork that had been suppressed. Meanwhile, eventually, the official launch of the cleanup in the Gondola was announced in June 2016. It is not entirely something that we don't want to claim. We don't want to claim that sending a sculpture to Nigeria caused them to announce the cleanup, because that's probably going too far. But we do want to say that it's interesting timing that after all these years, 1 year after we do these joint actions with our allies in Gondola, around Shell on Spurs, they finally announced the cleanup. They haven't done it since getting the sculpture. The sculpture is still seized. It is, in fact, as far as we know, the sculpture is being crushed. The sculpture might be dismantled and sold for scrap. The sculpture has not ever been seen, despite repeated requests and visits to Abuja by Agoni activists and by international climate, international petition indeed. And now the Agoni Solidarity Forum are taking Nigeria government to court. Now, these are people who can't drink their water. These are people who can't actually live in Igoni land. But they're seeing this sculpture as a symbol, as a very visible symbol of hope, of solidarity, but also of their suppression, that that sculpture can become a mouthpiece for continued suppression. So I suppose when I'm talking about hope and our bodies and our place, I've never been to Nigeria, but I know that Shell has. And in my name, in all of our names, they have been extracting oil from that land at enormous cost and with the lowest of standards. They do in Nigeria, as Ken Samari would say, what they would not do in the North Sea. It is entirely racist. It is entirely in cahoots with a very fractured state government of Nigeria. So how do we educate hope through these kind of alliances? Well, one thing is to keep going. Now, it's not that all of us have to keep going our whole lives on the same campaign, but Shell is still making profits in Nigeria. So we're already thinking, okay, 2020, that will be 25 years since the Igoni 9 were executed. You know, we must kind of keep this story running. We must not see any of this as failure, but all of it as an opportunity to create new hope. And even if the bus has been crushed into a small cube or incinerated, it still worked. It still worked hard. And it was, in fact, the artist who wanted that bus to go to Nigeria. She is from the Niger Delta. And I asked the director, are you prepared to lose the bus? And she said, yes. So, and that was an act of hope, not an act of despair. So I've kind of been musing about this, and especially today thinking about Fukushima and this enormity of the challenge of some of these parts of the world where absolute catastrophe has been precipitated. I thought I'd leave you with a quote from the ceremony, which I can almost do from memory. It just never leaves me. It's not an ego trip. It's serious. It's politics. It's economics. It's everything. And art in that instance becomes so meaningful, both to the artist and to the consumers of that art. So in this situation, with the challenges that we're facing environmentally, politically, there's everything to hope for in the work that we can make. And even the failures can be turned again into acts of hope. And those failures, if we strategize ourselves rightly, become signs of our resilience. Because it ain't going to get cleared up quickly. So what do we do? Just go away? That would be capitalism. So that's what I really wanted to contribute today. Thank you very much for listening.
It was amazingly on the time.
Oh, in that case. No, seriously, I have brought some rather lovely bits of print designed by John Daniel, if any of you would like, somewhere on the table there.